caption for this morning meditation is, Grace and peace unto you. Grace and peace unto you. We'll read Revelation chapter 1 verses 4, 5 and 6. Revelation chapter 1 verses 4, 5 and 6. John to the seven churches which are in Asia. Grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion for ever and ever. Amen. So it's from John. The center was John. John was in the island of Patmos as a prisoner. And this letter was sent to the seven churches in Asia. What is said Asia there was later called Asia Minor. What is today called modern Turkey? Most of the parts of modern Turkey was that Asia. There were seven churches. There are many more churches. There is a spiritual mystery why this letter was written to the seven churches. So all those things I am taking in the study. Now I am not spending time on that. The churches at Ephesus, Smyrna, and Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. Why these letters were sent only to these seven churches, not to the other churches? Near Laodicea there was the church at Colossae. The Rome was the capital of the emperor. Why a letter was not sent there? We find all these answers in the Bible study. If you are interested, you are welcome to the Bible study. Now I am not going to take a study on those details, but I want to give you the background. The church was going through a lot of persecution. In the days of King Domitian, towards the end of the first century, he was the son of Vespasian. Only in the days of Vespasian, Domitian's brother Titus, he destroyed the temple in Jerusalem. Thousands of Jews were killed, and the blood of the Jews were running through the streets of Jerusalem where the blood of Jesus was shed. And the complete nation was destroyed. The remnants were scattered all over the world. There was no country called Israel or Judea. It was erased of the map. It was erased of the map. It was in the days of the Vespasian. And under Titus, Jerusalem was destroyed. Titus became the Caesar later. And Titus was succeeded by his brother Domitian. And Domitian again introduced this emperor worship, worshipping the king. Even today we have got the practice of worshipping the political leaders. It was so a practice even before the days of Caesar, worshipping the kings as gods. We read in the Bible, Nebuchadnezzar made the people worship him. King Darius gave a command that everybody should worship him. I'm not getting into the details how this emperor worship came. What is the spirit behind it? Even today we have got that emperor worship. They worship the chief ministers. They worship the prime ministers, the people leaders. Domitian gave a command that all should worship him. And there was no problem with anybody because they all worshipped kings. The Judaism is destroyed, so Jews were scattered. So it was not a problem for Jews also. Only one community that was unable to worship the king. It was the Christians. So for the first time, organized torture started against the Christians. Even before that, the king Nero, the emperor Nero, he killed Paul, he killed Peter. But it was not an organized persecution against Christians. It was not an organized persecution against Christians. In the days of Domitian, Christians, there was an organized persecution against Christians. And the churches were ransacked. And John was at that time sent to Patmos as a prisoner. Patmos was a small island, 8 kilometers long, and only half a kilometer wide in its narrow place. Where are these prisoners sent? The rest, they were sent to Andamans. These prisoners are sent to Patmos. It's a death punishment. They have to go there. They have to die there. But when they are there, they got work to do. Cut the marbles, load the waiting ship, and send it to Rome to build the palaces. They are fed only for the work they do. If they can't work, if they are sick, if they are too old to work, they are not given any food. They have to starve and die. They have to starve and die. When a prisoner dies, they won't have a burial for a prisoner. They'll leave that body to get decayed. It'll be stinking. Worms will be crawling upon the body. The dogs, the wolves, the seabirds will feed on that body. When it starts sinking, the co-prisoners have to kick the body into the waters. It's a very terrible place. There was no cave, there was no tree in that island. So during the daytime, the prisoners will be under the sun. In the night, they have to suffer under the dew. Many prisoners, I read somewhere, they would become blind because they are seeing the bright sun all through the day. They would become blind soon. What the prisoners could hear, only the sound of the roaring waves, the noise of the whips of the Roman soldiers, and the hoofbeats of the soldiers' horses, the crying, the cursings of the soldiers, of the prisoners, swearing of the soldiers. Nothing they could hear. Death is certain for them. Only they are counting days for their death. Till their death, they have to suffer there. This is the predicament in which John was. This is the predicament in which John was. John must have had a wonderful question in his heart. What is next? What is next? I'm just very briefly giving the background. What is next? His brother was beheaded by Herod. One of his evangelists, Stephen, was stoned to death by the Jews. The church was persecuted. He heard that Thomas was killed in India. Peter was crucified upside down. Paul was thrown to the ring of lions. His bones were broken. He became a feed to the hungry lions. His disciples took the remnants of his bones and flesh and buried it. But now Domitian has unleashed a persecution against the church. John, probably the last in the apostles, he is in Patmos, in a death row. The church is persecuted. What is next? What is next? What will happen to the church? When he was with a great burden on a Lord's day, Jesus appeared unto him and gave him mighty revelations. So he wrote those revelations. In the Bible study, I said, what is the key verse for that revelation? What is in that book? So when John was giving his introduction to that book, in verse 5, he starts his writing like this. Very quickly I came into that. Grace be unto you and peace from so-and-so. That was his salutation. Grace be unto you and peace. So that epistle, it was not just a book on prophecy. It was written to the church that was going through persecution. It was written to a church that had an uncertain future. That was written to the church that was in a dark time. Even today, Revelation is not just a book of prophecies. It's not just a book of prophecies. It is a message to the people, those who are persecuted. It is a message to the people, those whose future is uncertain. It is a message to the people, those who go through a path of darkness. It is a message to you. It is not a prophetic book. It is a message, God's message to the suffering church. So John was starting with this salutation. Grace and peace be unto you. Probably the salutation is very familiar with the New Testament writers. But I love to tell you that was not just a nonsensical salutation. It's not just as you say, hello, how are you, howdy, good morning. It's not a nonsensical salutation. Jesus told his disciples, when you go into your house, when you greet that house, when you greet peace to that house, if that house is worthy enough to receive peace, that peace will come upon them. That peace will come upon them. So when the apostles write to the church and say, grace be unto you, certainly grace will come upon them. Grace will come upon that suffering church. When the apostle says, peace be unto you, certainly if they are worthy of that salutation, peace will come upon them. Grace will come upon them. It is not a nonsensical salutation. It is from the apostle, the anointed one. When they say grace be unto you, grace will come upon them. When they say peace be upon you, peace will come upon you. And he says it's not from John. It is from which was, which is, and which is to come. It is from seven spirits. It is from Jesus Christ. This grace is coming upon you. This peace is coming upon you. That word be unto you. That word be in Greek is called aimi. Aimee. Aimi. That word aimi means come into existence. It become. It comes into existence. What comes into existence? Grace will come into existence. Peace will come into existence, which is not, he calls that to come into existence. He calls which is not to be, it means calls that to be, to come into existence, which was not. My dear brother, my dear sister, all these things we studied there in detail, but I love to tell you, this grace will come into existence in your life. This peace will come into existence in your life. It will be unto you. It will come into existence. My dear brother, my dear sister. It will. In Tamil it's a beautiful word. Undavadaga. Undagum. Grace. Undagum. Peace. Undagum. It will come into existence. Praise be to the Lord's holy name. What is grace? We say grace, grace. What is grace that will come into existence in our life? Grace is called charis. Charis. The very literal meaning of that word charis. Beauty. Charisma. In Tamil we can say kavarchi. Something that attracts. Attracts our attention. Something that attracts our attention. Charis. Charisma. My dear brother, my dear sister, glory be to the Lord's holy name. The charisma, that beauty, what is that charisma? We say the gracious walk of a lion. The gracious walk of a lion. The gracious dance of a peacock. The beauty that acts beautiful, magnificent. We call that charis. In the invitation we say, come and grace the occasion. Come and grace the occasion. It means if you attend that program, it will add beauty to that program. It will add beauty to that program. You must come and grace that occasion. The gracious look of that person. The gracious words. Basically, grace charis means beauty, an attraction, a kavarchi. The walk, the look, the dance, the talk, the presence. That is charisma, a charismatic leader who is able to attract many people through his speech, through his lifestyle. He is very charismatic. My dear brother, my dear sister. So charis, kiruba means the first thing. It is beauty, very attractive. And the second meaning of the word charis means a divine influence. In a spiritual sense, aanmeega reethiyaga, in any religion maybe, aanmeegam, not religion, spiritual, a divine influence in the heart, the presence of God, the meditation, knowing the will of God, faith, confidence, trust, because of a divine influence in the heart, which reflects in our life, our walk, our look, our talk, our dress, our behavior, because of a divine influence in the heart, which reflects in our life, that is called charis. Because of a divine influence in the heart, we can smile at the storm, we can love our enemy, we can walk with confidence. Because we trust in the Lord, we are not getting perturbed. Our faith, that peace, because of a divine influence in our heart, which reflects in our life. That is called charisma. And philosophically, it is an enablement. In a Christian philosophy, it is an enablement that makes one live as God wants him or her to live. I'm able to live as God wants me to live. Something makes me live as God wants me to live. I love my enemy. It is not possible with me. It is an enablement. Somehow God enables me to love my enemy. When I'm called for the ministry, I don't know what the future holds for me. I was drawing monthly salary. I know how much salary I would get. And I was able to plan for my family. We were able to run our family without a paisa debt. Now I'm coming for the full-time ministry. I don't know from where money would come. But I'm able to trust in the Lord. I'm able to put my trust in the Lord. When I wanted to resign the job, my wife was not grumbling. She had the revelation from the Lord. She didn't have a question, how will we look after our children? How will we eat? How will we feed our children? How will we clothe our children? How will we educate our children? We were able to see what we could not see. That faith. We were able to believe what we could not believe. This is, God gives us grace, is an enablement to live as God wants me to live. We were able to honor our parents. God enabled us to live. God enabled us to honor our parents. So it is an enablement. It is an enablement what God provides, that we could live on the earth as God wants us to live. Humanly it is not otherwise possible. So I want you to understand, grace is not just a license to sin or mere deliverance from law. Today it's a very wrong teaching. Grace is a license to live as we want to live. A freedom from law. No, we don't have freedom from, it's not a freedom from law. What is actually grace? It gives us an energy to fulfill the law. To fulfill the law. Jesus came into this world. Jesus came into this world not to do away with the law, but to fulfill the law. To fulfill the law. I give a small illustration. Please listen. When a child starts learning to write, it writes on a four-ruled notebook. Four rules. Four-ruled notebooks. how the letter should be formed. It writes within four ruled notebook. As the child grows confidence, the child writes on two ruled notebook, double ruled notebook. We don't see the top line and the bottom line, only center two lines. How A should be, how B should be, how G should be, how T should be, where to cross the T. The T should not touch the first line. T should, the top of the T should be first, between the first and the second line. We learn to write. When you write R, the small letter, the cursive R, that circle must be above the second line. The teacher teaches within two rules. Now the child writes to learn. When the child gains confidence, it writes on a single rule notebook. It writes on single rule notebook. And the maturity, the child writes on an unruled notebook. But I ask a question. The child writes on an unruled notebook, but the child doesn't write unruly. The child doesn't write unruly. If the child's handwriting is good, though the lines are not seen, still the child will be writing within those four lines. Just to encourage you, I tell you, when I was a teacher, I'll write a sentence on the blackboard. And after that I call the students to draw the lines. Writing on the blackboard with no rule, yet when the writing is complete, still those four rules will be there. Then only the writing will be beautiful. You want to put your H. Your H goes somewhere. Goes very tall. And your O is very small. And you put G, and the G goes to the bottom of the page. Your writing will be horrible. It's unruly. This is where the people make mistake. They say no law, no law, no law, no rule, and they become unruly. Grace is not unruly. Grace gives us the energy to follow the rules, even when the rules are not there. When the rules are not there, we are not under the rules, but we follow the rules. We write the letters very carefully, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and then we draw the lines. All the four lines will be there. You are writing on an unruled notebook, but your writing is not unruly. That's the sign of maturity. Some people will have a beautiful handwriting and totally illegible. It seemed to be beautiful, nothing can be understood. Some people have a beautiful formation of the letters. They will be writing within the rules. My dear brother, my dear sister, we are not under rules, but we fulfill rules. So law is not, grace is not a license to be unruly. It's not a license to be unruly. Some people in their stupidity, they think that there is no law. Grace is given that we could fulfill law. We are not under law. I'm not writing on a four-rule notebook. No four rules. I don't see four rules, but I'm writing in four rules. It's ruling. Within the rule, I'm writing. My dear brother, my dear sister, there is always a law binding us. Your pronunciation, your grammar, only those things make it clear. You can't say, no, I'm not worried about pronunciation. Then we don't know whether you say hill or kill. You can't say, no, I don't worry about grammar. All these things are very, very essential to communicate. My dear brother, my dear sister, now get into the message. I'm just being only with the introduction. In Titus chapter 2, if you read from verse 11 to 13, now the time is not very short for me to read. There the grace teaches. If you have got the grace will teach you. Three things the grace teach: deny ungodliness and worldly lust. Who is the person with grace? Who is the person with grace? He has got a bell ringing within him. Deny ungodliness. Say no to ungodliness. Say no to ungodliness. Say no to worldly lust. That person has got grace. If you don't hear a bell against worldly lust, or if you have got a drive to live as the world lives, you are a person with no grace. You don't have the grace. You are an ordinary human being. You don't have the grace. How do you know that you have got the grace? The grace will teach you. The grace will instruct you. The grace will ring a bell within you. Say no to worldliness. Say no to worldly lust. Say no to ungodliness. It is not godly. Say no to ungodliness. You will hear an instruction. Then you are a person with a grace. And it teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. And it teaches that we should live soberly, righteously and godly in this present world. It is not escapism. It is not run away from this world. You deny worldly lusts, but live in this world soberly. You must have a sober mind. Why you dress like this? Why you want to have a beard? Why you want to put your churidar like that, a sari like that? Why do you want to keep your cap like this? Why do you want to wear jewels? Why do you want to remove jewels? Sober-minded. Sober-minded, sobriety. It's a very sad thing. Many people in this world, they don't live soberly. They're like dead fishes. Go with the stream of the world. But we must have sober mind. Live righteously, right standing with God. Soberly, righteously, and godly. And number three, it teaches us to be looking for the return of Jesus Christ. To be looking for the return of Jesus Christ, day in and day out. We have got a lively hope. Every day, will Jesus come today? Will Jesus come today? Will I meet Jesus soon? Every day, my dear brother, my dear sister, it is the sign of the people, those who have got grace. Those who have got grace. In Jude chapter 1 verse 4, in these last days, some people, they turn this grace into lasciviousness. The literal meaning of the word lasciviousness, it is a license for immoral life. A license for an immoral life. No, this grace God gives us. This grace God gives to the suffering church. Church that's persecuted. Grace to live as God wants you to live. To say no to ungodliness. To say no to worldly lust. To live soberly, righteously, godly. Always looking forward to the returning of Jesus Christ. This grace is given to us to fulfill the law of God in our life. Grace upon grace. So this salutation, grace be unto you. Grace is coming upon us. Just say, grace be unto you, grace be unto you. I got a very powerful passage to show to you. In Zechariah chapter 4, if you read from verse 6 to 9, from verse 6 to 9, I don't have time to read all those verses. Zechariah chapter 4 from verse 6 to 9. Now historically speaking, Zerubbabel, under the leadership of Zerubbabel, a group of Jews had come back to Jerusalem to build the temple that was destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar. They come back to build the temple, but the land was vast and wide and empty. When the people, those who came with Zerubbabel, they saw that open wasteland before them, instead of building the temple, everybody started building a house for him. Everybody started building a house for him. The project Zerubbabel started was not in progress. Probably Zerubbabel was a little worried. God sent two prophets, Haggai and Zechariah. They were in the days of Zerubbabel historically. They were Zerubbabel's peers. So they were encouraging Zerubbabel. God was encouraging Zerubbabel through their prophetic utterances. Now that project, that work was like a mountain before Zerubbabel. That work was like a mountain before Zerubbabel. So if you read from verse 6 to 9, the prophet Zechariah said a God's word, Zerubbabel, fear not. What this great mountain before Zerubbabel? This great mountain before Zerubbabel, this project of building the temple, this will become a plain ground. Yes, it will become a plain ground. Zerubbabel, don't worry. You have put the foundation. You have put the foundation to this temple. You will finish this work. The eyes of the Lord, the eyes of the Lord are looking at the plumb line that has got in your hands. Don't worry. You forget the people, those who have gone away from you to build their own houses. Don't worry about that. You have put the foundation. You are in the hands of the Lord. You have put the foundation. Don't worry, how will it happen? It's not by might. It's not by power. It's by the Spirit of God. That's where they said. This great work is not by power. It's not by might. It is by the power of God. It is by the Spirit of God. And that time the Lord gave a revelation to the other people in Zerubbabel. You don't worry about it. Let Zerubbabel put the cornerstone. You all do one thing. Grace be unto you, grace be unto you, grace be unto you. It will be done. It will be done. In the name of Jesus, I tell you, you pronounce grace. Let God's grace be upon you. Is your child going through a problem? Is your daughter? Is your son got a marital problem? Are you going through a problem? You think that work cannot be done? It's a massive project. Just open your mouth and say, Lord, grace be unto my daughter. Grace be unto my daughter. Grace be unto my daughter. Grace be unto my son. Grace be unto my son. Lord, grace be unto me. Grace be unto my father. Just send that word. It will be done. Not by power, not by might, but my spirit, saith the Lord. Just you say one thing, grace be unto it, grace be unto it, grace be unto it. There is power in your pronunciations. It's not just chanting a mantra. But when you say, grace be unto you, and if the recipient is worthy of your salutation, that salutation will come upon him. That salutation will come upon that family. The salutation will come upon that project. The salutation will come upon that business. When an apostle could say, this grace will come upon them. Grace be unto you. Grace be unto you. Not only you pronounce grace upon somebody, you pronounce shalom. Peace, irony, in Greek irony, in Hebrew shalom, pronounce it upon somebody. So what is the greeting John was giving? Charis and shalom, or charis and irony. Come upon the people, those who are persecuted, those who are living with uncertain days, those who don't see a leader now, their apostle is also murdered, or they are sent to prison. What will they do? Grace be unto you. Peace be unto you. My dear brother, my dear sister, from whom? I'm going to tell you three things. Not only I'm getting into the message part. This grace, this peace, from whom? We studied all these things in detail in the Bible study for 2 weeks, which I want to compress it in an hour. From whom this grace will come upon you? From whom this peace will come upon you? Just a cursive reading will not help you. Read carefully verses 4, 5, 6. Verse 4. From him which is, and which was, and which is to come. From him which is, and which was and which is to come. Number two, and from the seven spirits which are before the throne. From the seven spirits which are before his throne. Number three, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and princes unto God and his Father. So it's from three persons. So here we read this little word, from Christ, from him, from the seven spirits, from Jesus Christ. So grace is coming upon you from whom? The Lord promises grace to you. The Lord promises peace to you. From whom? From where it comes? From where it comes? Is it from John? Is it from an apostle? From whom this grace is coming to you? My dear brother, my dear sister, number one, from which is and which was and which is to come. What do we mean by that? We see three things. We see three things. Which is, which was, and which is to come. When John was writing in the Greek, John said, one being, one was, one coming. From where do you get your grace? One being, one was, one coming. What does it mean? One being, one was, one coming. That speaks about an eternal God who was, who is, and who shall be. Is Yahweh. I am what I am. My dear brother, my dear sister, in all these three things I want to say a lot of things. He was even before the beginning. The beginning began in the Lord. He was before the beginning. He was, one was. One was, he was in the beginning. The beginning began in him. He was with Noah. He was with Noah. He was with Abraham. He was with Moses. As he was with Moses, he is with Joshua. So he told Joshua, Joshua, I am with you. I am. With you, as I was with Moses, I have not changed. Now John was writing to the persecuted saints. He is as he was. He is as he was. He has not changed. He has not changed. He is as he was. As he was with Moses. As he was with Elijah, he is with Elisha. Elijah lived in a different time. Elisha lived in a different time. But as he was with Elijah, he was with Elisha. As he was with Peter, as he was with John, he was with D.L. Moody, he was with David Livingstone. As he was with David Livingstone, he was with Sadhu Sundar Singh. As he was with Sadhu Sundar Singh, he was with Sundaram. As he was with Sundaram, he is with Robert Simon. Times may change, situations may change. But an unchanging God, Yahweh, an eternal God is with me. The church may go through persecution. As he was with Peter and John. As he was with Paul, with Thomas. They all are killed. But today, as he was with James, he is with John. He has not changed. Fear not. How this grace is coming from this God who never changes. This grace is coming from God who never changes. From this great God, this grace is coming upon you. My dear brother, my dear sister. As he was, he is, and he shall be. Let come what may. When he is with me, I can face it tomorrow. Because he lives, he shall be, he will not become exempt. He will not become exempt. There was a great, there was a philosopher by nature. He was the son of a pastor. Nietzsche believed in Jesus. He believed in the death of Jesus. He never believed God. He said God was. Jesus died on the cross. God died. No God. That was the philosophy of Nietzsche. But John's philosophy, Jesus died on the cross. John saw Jesus risen again. So John knew Jesus was, Jesus is, and Jesus shall be. An eternal God is with us. Before marriage, God was with you. When you are in your mother's house, God was with you. When you have gone to your husband's house, God is with you. God is with you. When your father was there, God was with you. When your husband is with you, God is with you. When there is no one with you, God is with you. Why should you fear any evil? I can go on and on. I got a lot of things to tell you. Just for a study part, a careful reading. This God, in all three times, sit on the throne. It is one God who was, who is, and who shall be. I got a lot of things to tell you. Please listen. Here it says, one from him which is, and which was, and which is to come, is one person. Which was, which is, which is to come. And upon his throne, he has got a throne. He has got a reign. Alugai. In all your life, whatever may happen, he is still on the throne. In the name of Jesus, I tell you this morning, it is the Lord's message. I thought it was only for those who attended the Bible study. It is the grace of God. The Lord wanted to bring this message to the church. My dear brother, my dear sister, he is still on the throne. His reign is on the throne. We got a careful reading in the book of Revelation. At least in 7 places you could read that he is on the throne. And those 7 places will be a separate message. I don't want to get into that. From that eternal God, from the God who sits on the throne, from the God who is, always is, from that one God who has got all power in heaven and on earth, from that one omnipotent God, from that one omniscient God, from that omnipresent God, your grace is coming. Your peace is coming. Let grace be unto you. Grace that comes from that eternal God. And John didn't stop with that. My dear brother, my dear sister, study by Jesus said, is not reading the Bible. You shall have eternal life when you study the Bible. When you come on a Sunday, you just hear a portion. But if you can make it for a Bible study, you study the Bible. You search the scriptures. When you search the scriptures, you'll have an everlasting life. You will have an everlasting life. That's a promise. When you search the scriptures. So when you search the scriptures, this God, this eternal God, is on the throne. At least in the book of Revelation, it is mentioned 7 times that he sits on the throne. And the 7 times speaks about 7 different situations we can face in our life where we see Jesus sitting on the throne. Now I don't have time to explain that. He didn't say it is just from one is, one be, one was, and one coming. He said from the 7 spirits which are before the throne, which are before his throne. So which is to come, which was, one person. From his throne, he is only one person. So seven spirits before the throne. So this grace, this peace is coming from seven spirits. Seven spirits before the throne of God. What do we mean by seven spirits which are before the throne of God? If you go to Isaiah chapter 11, if you read verses 1 and 2, Isaiah chapter 11, when you read 1 and 2, there you read about seven spirits. That is the menorah, the candlestand, which was kept in the holy place of the tabernacle. Seven, the candlestand with seven candles. They are the seven spirits before the throne of God. Before the mercy seat. This candlestand, everything is a study. I don't have time in this short time. This candlestand is before the throne of God. The seven spirits before the throne of God. It's one Holy Spirit. One Spirit of God with seven attributes. Spirit of the Lord. Spirit of wisdom and understanding. The Spirit of counsel and might. The Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. This is the seventh spirit. The first one, the Spirit of the Lord, that speaks about the governance. If you read from verses 3 to 10, that speaks about the governance. What a powerful governance of the Lord. If you want to know that in detail, you'll be able to collect that CD. The seven spirits. Now I don't have time to explain. That speaks about the governance of the Lord. God's wisdom, God's understanding, and God's counsel or God's guidance, and God's, God gives us courage to walk in that guidance. And the knowledge, what God knows we know, and the fear of the Lord. This is the completeness of the Holy Spirit. God's ruling, God's wisdom, and God's understanding, unarvu. We are able to understand. We are able to discern what is right, what is wrong. God gives in that spirit. God gives us wisdom. God gives us counsel when we are turned to the left or to the right. Guidance. Walk this is the way, walk herein. He teaches unto profit. And courage, might to walk in that counsel. All comes from that spirit. God's governance, God's wisdom, and an understanding. And in that study, I have spoken very clearly what we mean by understanding. And guidance. And we get the power. And we get the knowledge. Discerning. Power. Knowledge. We know what is right, what is wrong. Knowledge. And we get the fear of the Lord. We fear no man. Whatever the government may be, we fear no man. We have got only the fear of the Lord. Fear of the Lord eschews fear of men. When this spirit, from this spirit, this alone takes me one day, from this spirit, grace and peace come to us. Grace and peace come to us. So from God Almighty, eternal God, from the Holy Spirit, or God's Spirit, number three, from Jesus Christ. It's very simple to say from Jesus Christ, but John was giving a beautiful definition of this Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. So the eternal God, one be, one was, one coming. Eternal God, Yahweh. And from seven spirits of God, his governance, his wisdom, his understanding, his guidance, his courage, and his knowledge, fear of him. From this eternal spirit, from God we get grace and peace. From this eternal spirit we get grace and peace. And number three, from Jesus Christ. About Jesus Christ, he gives 7 points. Number one, he is the Christ. Number two, he is the faithful witness. Number three, he is the first begotten of the dead. Number four, he is the prince of the kings of the earth. Number five, he that has loved us. Number six, he that has washed us from our sins in his own blood. Number seven, from one that was made us kings and priests unto God and the Father. So it's Jesus Christ. 7 attributes of Jesus. From that Jesus we are getting peace. From that Jesus we are getting grace. It apparently seems to be simple. Just think about one thing. He washed us from his own blood. So I asked a question in the Bible study. Jesus washed us from his own blood. From where did he get blood? From where did he get blood? How did blood come into his body? He was born of the Holy Spirit, not born of the blood. What was the blood in Jesus? I asked a question. Jesus loved us. Why did he love us? What is loving us? What is the purpose behind it? Why should God love us? And what is meant by Jesus loved us? My dear brother, my dear sister, I'll be preaching on these 7 characteristics of Jesus Christ, probably on the 27th Wednesday. The 7 characteristics of Jesus Christ. It's very powerful, very deep. From where did he get blood? How did he make us kings and priests? What did he do for that? What is the mystery behind it? Why should he love us? But one thing, from this Jesus Christ, we are getting our grace and peace. Now in this small passage, we see this grace and peace come to us from an eternal God, from the 7 spirits which is before the throne of that God, and from Jesus Christ. Are they 3? Yes, they are 3. But are we not believing it one God? That we see in Revelation chapter 22. Revelation chapter 22. There we see the same throne. The throne in which God the Father and Jesus sit. And from that throne, a river flows. So 3 things are in that throne. God the Father is on the throne. God the Spirit is on the throne. God the Lamb is on the throne. And from the throne, this grace and peace are coming to us. From that one triune God, who has got power and dominion forever and ever. From that one God, grace and peace coming to you. Shall we just stand to our feet? We are going to pronounce these blessings upon you. The church was going through persecution, torture, uncertainties. The church was living in darkness. All the saints are passing by. My dear brother, my dear sister, what the church needed today, grace. What the church needed today, peace. Grace and peace are coming from the Lord. Grace and peace are coming from the Lord. Lift up your hands and cry unto the Lord. Lord, give me your grace. Grace that makes you live as God wants you to live. Grace brings that divine beauty, the heavenly beauty in our walk, in your laugh, in your smile, in the midst of torture, in the midst of persecution. Grace upon grace, grace upon grace. Everybody has persecuted, everybody has forsaken you. The task was too big before you to accomplish. Only one thing, You pronounce grace be upon it. Grace be upon it. Grace be upon it. Is your daughter going through a path of suffering? Is your son going through a path of suffering? Is your business going through a path of suffering? Is your dad, your mother, are they going through a path of uncertain future? Just open your mouth and say, Lord, grace be upon them. Grace be upon them. Peace be upon them. Grace be upon your children. Grace be upon your church. Grace be upon your family. Peace be upon your family. Hallelujah. Grace and peace be upon you. Grace and peace be upon you. As the servant of God, as the servant of God for you, I pronounce grace be upon you. I pronounce peace be upon you. It shall be upon you. It's from an eternal God. It's from God the Father, God the Son, and the God the Holy Spirit. It is from which was, which is, and which is to come. It is from the seven spirits that is before the throne of God. It is from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the only begotten of the day, the first of the begotten of the day. Hallelujah. It is from Jesus who loves you. It is from Jesus who washes you from all your sins. Grace and peace. Grace and peace are coming to you from Jesus Christ who makes you priests and kings before him. Hallelujah. Receive it. Receive it. Open up your mouth and receive it. Open it. Open your mouth wide. He will fill you. Hallelujah. Lift up your hands and receive His grace. Lift up your hands and receive His peace. Open up your hearts and receive His peace. Peace and grace be upon you. Peace and grace be upon you. Grace and peace be upon you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. From God the Father, from God the Son, from God the Holy Spirit. One little word, a very powerful word. Amen. When you say Amen, all these things what you heard, it shall be so unto you. Can you just shout and say Amen? Those who believe, say Amen. Amen again and again. Amen. Shout and say Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Don't stop. Shout and say Amen. Amen. Let this grace and peace be upon you. Amen. When I say grace and peace be upon you, you shout and say Amen. 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 Let it be so. God bless you.